Good morning. And welcome to worship today. It's good to look out and see so many in person as we prepare to celebrate the ordinance of believers' baptism during our worship service today. You will also see an insert in addition to baptism. We will be celebrating Oriana's dedication here in just a few minutes. But it is indeed a beautiful day that we're able to be here, and we are thankful for the day that our Lord has made. I'd also like to take a moment to welcome those who are viewing today through our web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be upon you all as well. I'm going to hit this information about as quick as I know how, and for that I know you will be very thankful. One thing I want to go back to, this is actually the insert from last Sunday. This is concerning the Senior Adventures Fun Day, which is coming up next Saturday, the 10th. That will be in Heritage Hall with lunch beginning at 11:30, and then there will be a time of fun and games afterward. You can see either Charlie or Diane if you would like to know more information or get your name on that sign-up sheet. And then coming up in a little over a month, the Senior Adventures are also making plans to go to the Rudy Theater for the Easter Jubilee. That's coming up on Thursday, March the 14th. Tickets are $28. And as of yesterday, during the Cookies with Seniors, there were 8, I believe, tickets left. I think that's correct. There are 8 tickets left. So they're going very quickly. There was a limit of 21 anyway, so please see Charlie or Diane to get those tickets as soon as possible. As far as inside of the bulletin goes, the flowers today have been given for the glory of God and also in loving memory of Edison and Eunice Ellis's birthdays by Rosalie Barden. And we say thank you to you and your family for the beautiful flowers and the plant today. Marcy, are there things you'd like to share? I know we've got Winter Jam coming up in a few weeks and
yes,
a few other things.
Don't forget that Valentine's Day is also Ash Wednesday,
yep,
and we will be having those services at Lambs Grove Pentecostal Church, Pentecostal Holiness, there by Springfield. And so we will have after-school program, but we will not have family night meal and our Wednesday night activities that night. So parents need to make arrangements to pick up the kids, or we'll take them home. Then February 24th,
yep,
is Winter Jam. Those tickets are $15. That's open to anyone who would like to go, but please let us know so we can make sure that we have appropriate transportation. And then May 17th through 19th is the Youth Convention at UMO, University of Mount Olive. So I need some chaperones for that, as well as kids to go with us. So it's the whole weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday morning, and we'll be back in time for the birthday lunch, because that's the church's birthday that day.
Yep.
And then if you want to sign your kid up to go to camp, as long as they are third grade or older, they can go without a parent going with them, or if you want to talk to me, and then we'll figure out if we think they're good enough to go without a parent. But that is the last week in June. I don't know those dates off the top of my head. But we need to get those forms in quickly because we maxed out the girls' dorm last year. So we need to make sure that we have our spots because we're anticipating more. And I don't know who this came from, but it was laying in our bushes this morning. And it says, happy birthday. And I thought that was appropriate because it's not only Kelsey's physical birthday, but it's going to be the new birthday of 5 members of our church family. So,
at this time, let us prepare our hearts for
worship. Oh,
stand if you are able and join us in the responsive call to worship. All creation proclaims the greatness and love of God. God's love permeates even the deepest darkness. The light of God shines on us with new hope. We are called to be people of compassion and justice. Open our hearts, O Lord, to see your light and live in your hope. Prepare us for service to all your people and to this world. Mr. Phil Wiggs, will you lead us in our invocation?
If there's anyone else in our congregation this morning, Lord, that doesn't know you as their Savior, it'd be a great time to step out and take that leap of faith. Be with us, Lord. Bless us. Stay with us always. We ask these things in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Our song of celebration is page 92, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Your neighbors, give them a wave, a smile, and wish them God's peace.
case you haven't noticed, today is going to be a very busy worship service. Today is going to be a first in my ministry, probably a first in Marcy's ministry as well, as we're going to celebrate all of the ordinances today in one worship service. We're going to practice believer's baptism. We're going to wash the candidates' feet. We're going to offer them Holy Communion. And we're going to dedicate the youngest member of Coy and Naomi's family here in just a moment. If you'll refer to your insert for this special time of child dedication. This is a happy and meaningful occasion which we now observe. Like Hannah, the mother of Samuel, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, Coy and Naomi have brought their daughter, Oriana Grace Pritchett, to the house of God to present her. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven. This young life, born out of your love, which you hold in your arms and in your hearts, is both a miracle and a great blessing. God has already spoken loudly into your hearts the compelling message of the value and dignity of life and the challenges, responsibilities, and opportunities of parenthood. The Bible bears witness that godly parents dedicated their children to the Lord and to the Lord's service. We are confident of divine approval as children are brought to be dedicated to God and God's service. It is our duty as a Christian congregation of the original Free Will Baptist faith tradition to receive children into the care and nurture of the church and to minister to their welfare in every way possible. Jesus said, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. The Old Testament book of the law states these words that I command you today shall be upon your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit down in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. These principles are designed to show our children the way unto God."
As our dean in divinity school said, today is a high and holy day. This is a day that children and youth ministers live for, as well as parents. God has a purpose for Oriana's life. A part of that purpose is for her to be a whole, complete, and godly human being. It is your privilege and responsibility to guide your child in such a way as to make the will of God the central ambition of her life. To this task, you are called to dedicate yourselves today. To this end, you dedicate your child to God. In accordance with the purpose for which we observe this part of our worship, as Oriana's father and mother, I invite you to share in this covenant of dedication. Coy and Naomi, do you dedicate yourselves to bringing up Oriana in the nurture and admonition of the Lord?
Yes,
we do.
Oh, we do.
By the grace of God.
Do you promise to instruct her in the Bible, in the practice of prayer, to guide her in the development of Christ-like character, and to diligently bring her to the services of the church where she will be taught the Christian way of life?
We do,
as is witnessed by God and the body of Christ gathered here as Little Rock.
Do you promise, to the best of your ability, to so shape your home life by family devotions and by your words and example that at the proper time and age she will come to an open confession of faith in Christ, following Christ in baptism and appropriating by a living faith that spiritual life that comes in and through Jesus Christ, thereby coming into the fellowship and service of the church?
We do so affirm this covenant, seeking God's blessing and direction upon our home and family.
Do you, the congregation of Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church, agreed to provide a place of Christian nurture, instruction, fellowship, and service for this child and all children who may grace this congregation with their presence.
We do. The Holy Spirit being our constant companion and guide.
Oriana Grace Pritchett was not born in December of 2023.
But she did turn 3 in 23.
But she was born on December 8th, 2023. 20. We, your ministers, your family, and the body of Christ gathered here as Little Rock, dedicate you to God and to the service of God's kingdom. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer of dedication.
O God, grant that this child, as she grows in years, may also grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that by the restraining and renewing influence of the Holy Spirit, she may ever be your child, serving you faithfully all of her days. So guide and uphold us, her family, ministers, and congregation of believers, that by loving care, wise counsel, and holy example, we may lead her and all children into that life of faith, whose strength is righteousness, and whose fruit is everlasting joy and peace, that may issue in faithful service and fruitful witness for Christ, through Christ our Savior and Lord. Amen.
And Oriana, this is your first Bible. And then this is a certificate of dedication, and we still need to sign it. Will you walk with me down the aisle, Oriana?
Yeah, walk with me.
Show me your book.
This is a tradition at Little Rock that we always show off the baby or child who's being dedicated.
Notice in the bulletin your worship order is flip-flopped a little bit, and the sermon will take place now instead of later on in the worship service. If you have your Bibles today and would like to follow along with our sermon text, it is taken once again from the epistle known as 1 John, the 4th chapter, and this morning we'll be looking at verses 7 through 12. 1 John chapter 4, verses 7. Through 12. May we give ear to the reading of God's word. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way: God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us first and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. Brothers and sisters, may God add a blessing to this, the reading, hearing, understanding, and living of these words for our days. Amen. Some years back, a fellow original Free Will Baptist minister was sharing a story from early on in his ministry. It came from his first pastorate. He was settling into this new ministry and getting to know some of the people and their personalities, and he was also getting to know some of the cooking habits of some of its parishioners. He had already been warned that there was a lady in the congregation who tried to cook. But it didn't always work out so well. And of course, this minister trying to give people the benefit of the doubt says, well, how bad can it possibly be? One of their special feast days came around, and on that Sunday, this particular lady brought a dish, but not only a dish for that particular occasion, she also brought a little bit extra for the preacher to take home with him. Well, not being one to hurt feelings, this minister had a taste of it during that fellowship lunch, and he didn't say anything. But the next week, when he came back to church and he was confronted by that lady prior to the worship service, she said, "Preacher, what did you think about whatever that dish was?" He said, "The only thing that I could say in that moment was, I've never had anything quite like it before." As I said, he wanted to give this lady the benefit of the doubt. He was not going to criticize her cooking abilities or inabilities until he had the opportunity to taste it for himself. And that's how it is with a lot of things in life. It's easy for us to offer our judgment at a distance. We can say that, well, I don't like thus and such. I'll go ahead and tell you, I don't like deviled eggs. I don't like boiled eggs. I know that's probably anti-Christian. That should get me stoned according to the Old Testament law and covenant. But I've tried them, and I found them wanting many times. Yes, and the first time I ever ate and met your parents, Marcy said, "Oh, I don't know of anything that he won't eat." That night I ate 2 deviled eggs, and I didn't say a word about it until one day the next week when I was conversing with Marcy. Lime green jello, absolutely. Mm-mm-mm. Or anything congealed by that matter. You've often heard that saying that the proof is in the pudding. And really, that's kind of a corruption of the actual saying. The true saying goes like this: the proof of the pudding is in the eating. After all, how can you know that the proof is in the pudding unless you've tried this, whatever it might be? And in a way, that's sort of what John is telling us about our relationship with God and the love that is capable only through a personal, abiding relationship with God. The proof is in the love. You can say, you can do, but unless you love, you really don't have it, do you? How many times does the word show up in those few verses? 13. 13 variations of either the noun or the verb form of love. God is love. When we love, we do so because God lives in us. any other way, and John says it just doesn't fly. It just doesn't work that way. You can say you have a relationship with God. You can say all of the right things. You can use the right terminology. But unless you're doing the loving, then really you don't know God. The first point is this. It is in knowing God that we know how to love. It's only because we know God that we know the fullest extent of love. Not mushy, not Valentine's Day is a week from Wednesday, but the essence of love, that selfless, sacrificial quality of love. We love because love finds its beginning in God. And unless we have met this God and know God, and by knowing I don't mean facts and information, I don't mean just going to Sunday school or reading a theological text, I mean knowing God in that intimate and personal way that says we truly have a relationship with God. We have, as one of my professors said at Mount Olive years ago, a heart knowledge and not merely a head kind of knowledge. It's in knowing God that we know how to love. How well do you and I really know God? How much time do we spend with God? Because the only way we can take on godly attributes is when we spend time enjoying our relationship with the one in whom love has been created. A second point is this, that genuine love is both a matter of choice and action. True love doesn't simply happen. How many times have I heard people talk about marriages, that they are hard work? You have to invest a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy. There's a lot of ups, there's a lot of downs. It takes both of you working through the tough times and the easy times. And I'll admit, my wife is over here to my left. I'll be careful what I say. She probably has to choose to love me some days. But it goes both ways. Because believe it or not, brothers and sisters, we're not always the most lovable of people, are we? We're all in love as we're moving toward the wedding day. We make it through the wedding, the honeymoon, and then we wake up and we see his pile of clothes on the floor, or her makeup strewn all over the bathroom vanity. That would be Kelsey. It's hard to love. It's something we have to choose. And God chooses to love us in spite of ourselves. And let's be honest, some people in this world, some people maybe in this congregation, another congregation down the road, may not be the easiest to love. It's a conscious decision that you and I have to make, and it's not always one based upon feelings. Because if you and I do not love those whom we can see, how can we possibly love the one whom we've never, ever laid eyes upon? It's really something to think about. It's a matter of choice and action. It's a matter of doing. How many times as a child told to do something and then he or she doesn't want to do it? Got some hands back here in the choir, Tony and Brody. Oh, Kelsey's holding. She's bold enough to hold up her hand. We tell them to do something, or we tell them not to do something, and then they still do whatever against our wishes. They come back and they apologize to us, and sometimes we question the sincerity of that apology. Are you really sorry about something, or are you sorry that you got caught? Are you just saying it to pay lip service to me? If you're really sorry, you need to change your behaviors. That's how it is with the love of God. We can declare up and down that we love God, that we love our neighbor as ourselves, but if there are no actions to back up our profession, our love is merely a facade. That brings me to a third and final point, that our loving actions are a reflection of the divine in us, the fact that God dwells in us. When we make this profession of faith, when we join the kingdom of God, we don't become perfect people. As I was sharing in the previous chapter last Sunday, we're still in a process of becoming more and more like Jesus Christ every day. We take steps forward, we take steps back. We get it right one day, we get it wrong the next day. God begins something in us. But when this begins and we truly live out through loving actions a sincere relationship with God, it is proof. It is the proof that God is truly inside of our hearts. And brothers and sisters, that goes beyond being on the church membership roster. It means more than going to Sunday school every Sunday. It means more than being able to talk the right spiritual language. It means that we are sincerely doing the things of the kingdom because God is in us. We can't love unless we know God. And how will the world know love unless God's love is truly in each of us? I love the quote that I shared there on your insert. It says, "Do not think that love, in order to be genuine, has to be extraordinary." I think sometimes that's our sticking point. We feel as though love has to be done in some way that's noticeable, that's impressive to other people, but that's not always the case. Sometimes it's in the simple, selfless, ordinary, everyday kinds of activities that God sees us loving other people. And other people see God's love in us and through us. Years ago, there was a statement that said, you can walk the talk, or you can talk the talk, but can you walk the walk? That's a tough thing for Christians sometimes. Because let's be honest, you look at the world today and you don't see a whole lot of love, do you? You look at a lot of people, how they treat each other. Think of someone coming back into a fast food restaurant a few weeks ago and storming up to the counter and slamming her bag down on the counter, demanding to see the manager because something was off on her order. Think about the person who cut you off in traffic just to turn into a business a short distance up the road. Think about the two neighbors who were standing in their yard in Cary a couple of weeks ago who were shot and killed. Think of all of the events that are currently unfolding with Israel. You don't have to go far and wide to discover a lack of love in our world. But what difference would it make if we really, truly started to love? How could this church be a different congregation? How could this community be a different community? How could our nation, our world, be changed for the better? I close with an illustration from the Kendrick movie known as Fireproof. Features Kirk Cameron. And the premise behind this whole movie is a bad marriage relationship. It's rocky between the husband and the wife. It's falling apart. There's nothing seemingly going to save this partnership. And Kirk Cameron's character is talking with his dad in one scene in that movie. They're going back and forth. She doesn't this, and she won't that. And the whole time this is going on, the camera is panning around. And suddenly the scene stops. And I remember it every time I have seen it. It's given me chills. The father stands before the cross when the camera pauses. And the father looks at Kirk Cameron's character and says, "Son, you can't give what you don't have." The same is true for us today. You and I can't give what we don't know. Have you been ignoring and neglecting that love of God, the love that was shown on the cross at Calvary 2,000 years ago, a love that moved even before you and I realized that we had need of a Savior? If we truly want this world to be a different place and we really want to know the fullness of love, we have to experience it through the relationship that exists only with God through Jesus Christ. And once we have that relationship, it must be more than words. It has to be proved through its actions. Thanks be unto God, brothers and sisters. Amen and amen. As we move to our time of prayer, I refer your attention to the back of our bulletin. You'll see many names reflected there in our church family. And throughout this surrounding community, names we know, names we don't recognize. But before we go into prayer, I wonder, are there praises you would like to share with the church family today? It is a high and holy day indeed. Absolutely. Koi? Absolutely. Definitely. We're so glad to have you all as a part of our church family, and we'll make all of that official here in just a couple of moments. I'm thankful for yesterday. Miss Kay, would you like to say more? Absolutely. Definitely. Baking cookies, making a craft, playing a game around a table. It was beautiful. See middle schoolers and senior adults interacting, helping each other, encouraging one another, getting to know each other. Worship and discipleship isn't limited just to a sanctuary or a Sunday school classroom. When our hearts and our eyes are really open, we can see God doing some beautiful things in the most unlikely of people and places. Anyone else with a praise today? Yes, the community prayer vigil.
There may not have been maybe 30 or 35 of us, but there were a lot of churches represented, and it was very meaningful.
Absolutely.
And I hope it brings unity in this community.
Something we still very much need in this community is unity, and yesterday, I hope, was just the beginning of a step in that direction, hopefully the beginning of other prayer services with community ministers and leaders and lay people. Again, great service, praying for unity in the community, praying for our town commissioners, our mayor, our businesses, our school. Again, a wonderful time on a Saturday afternoon at 4 o'clock. God showed up.
And those of us who went to the Mount Olive basketball game.
Yes.
We had a good time fellowshipping with each other and watching basketball, and both teams won.
Good day for Mount Olive. Their teams haven't been doing so well this season. They're getting there. We all have our moments. As we turn to our Heavenly Father in prayer and we look at the names on the bulletin, we do wish to remember the family of Ann Godwin, who went to be with our Lord and Savior yesterday morning. And as soon as those arrangements have been finalized, they're meeting with the funeral home as we speak. I will pass that information along to our church family. Also, please remember my former high school Bible teacher, Doug Weber, as he's preparing for surgery for a brain tumor coming up on Tuesday of this week. Are there other names, other needs that are close to you this morning? Perhaps by uplifted hand. God sees each and every heart, and God understands the depths of our hurts and our needs. Would you bow with me for a moment of prayer? Lord, today feels just like what Moses must have experienced before the burning bush. And then he heard those words through the flames, "Moses, take off your sandals, for the ground you are standing upon is holy." What can we say, Lord? What can we possibly do in your presence other than bow down just like the heavenly beings in the book of Revelation and call out, "Holy, holy, holy are you." Because, God, we can't even begin to get our hearts and our minds completely around you. And to think that you would love humanity so much that you would take the initiative and send your son Jesus to be our atoning sacrifice, it blows our minds because, Lord, we're sinful. We're broken. We're falling. And even when we confess, a lot of times we turn around and do the same things again and again and again. Lord, do a new work in our hearts. Break the cycle. Forgive us of our sins and our selfishness. And help us, Lord, to be the kind of light that this world greatly needs in this generation. The only way that we can be the light is when the true source of light lives in us and shines through us. Lord, today we say thank you for so many wonderful things that you have done and will continue to do in our lives in the journey to come. We thank you for the commitment of faith for those who are going to be baptized in just a few moments. Help us, Lord, as a community of faith to be a support system to help nurture them as they grow more and more like Christ daily. Lord, I ask that you would be with all of the needs that we bring today for families who are grieving, individuals who are hospitalized, people who are struggling in any way, shape, or form. We know that you feel and you understand our hurts, no matter how big or small they may seem in our human eyes. Lord, hear the prayers of your children this day as we intercede for all of those mentioned verbally and the many that were unspoken. Now, Lord, continue with us in this season of worship. And be with us, Lord, as we go back out into the highways and byways of life so that we might be equipped to be your hands and feet in the days to come. This prayer we lift up in your Son's most precious and holy name.
Thank you.
you to join me here front and center for a moment. We did this with Kelsey at the end of our worship service last week. And so they are no strangers to our church family. They've been with us for probably about a good 2 years, good two full years now. And they wish to come and make an official connection with the Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church family. They come expressing their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. They will be going through the waters of baptism momentarily. What are the wishes of this church body? Does that meet with a second? Motion and second. On the count of three, simply invite them into this church family officially by offering the word welcome, okay? One, two, three. Welcome. Welcome indeed. Thank you all so much. Thank you, church family. I'll let you all have a seat for just a moment.
So Kelly picked out a scripture verse for me to read, but I'm going to pull over one on him and read something a little different as well.
Okay.
When I was searching through pictures to post on Facebook of Kelsey for her 10th birthday today, I came across a picture of her laying her head on the Bible, and an afghan that Aunt Bonnie had made was laying over Kelsey. And the Bible was open to Psalm 139, and I think that is very fitting for this occasion. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. For it was you who formed me, my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. And I come to the end. I am still with you. And now, the gospel reading from John chapter 1, verses 29 through 34. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be unto God. I'm going to invite our candidates for baptism to come and join me here at the communion table. Before we go into the waters of baptism, before they receive communion and the washing of their feet in just a moment, I would like to go ahead and present them with their baptismal certificates, celebrating today's joyous occasion. And then something else that I do as a tradition in connection with baptism, and I'll present them with that after the presentation of their certificates. Kelsey Smart, Coy Pritchett, Naomi Palacio, Brody Palacio, and Damian Jaimez. And if you'll let me slide right through there. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus tells his followers that we are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Today is a tremendous step of faith that you all are taking as you enter into the family of God through the body of Christ here at Little Rock Original Free Will Baptist Church. Life will not always be easy just because you profess faith. You'll still have some struggles from time to time, but in spite of that, God still uses each of us to be his witnesses in the world. And that's the reason as we speak, as we interact with other people, we should show them the loving kindness of the same God who has shown his loving kindness to us. Kelsey, you are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Coy, you are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Naomi, you are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Damian, you are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Brody, you are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. If our candidates would please be seated here on the front pew, and if the deacons who are serving in this special time of the ordinances would come and join me. The scriptures tell us on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples in the upper room to share in the Passover celebration. And during the meal, Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave thanks. And when he gave it to the disciples, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat." And in a like manner, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, gave it also to the disciples and said, "Take and drink, for this is the fruit of the vine. This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood poured out for the forgiveness of all sins." And in the words of the Apostle Paul to the believers in Corinth, we continue to celebrate this today. For as often as we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup, we remember our Lord's death, burial, and resurrection until he comes again one day. Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, for this ordinance of believers' baptism, we say thank you. ask, Lord, a special blessing upon these candidates as they receive the elements of Holy Communion and the washing of their feet. Lord, I ask that you would bless both bread and cup. Let it be a reminder of your love and your sacrificial goodness unto us. In Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters, this is the body of Christ broken for each of you. Let us take and eat. This is the blood of Christ, which is poured out for the forgiveness of all sins. Let us take and drink. In John chapter 13, we're told that once dinner had been served, Jesus excused himself from the table. He removed his outer garment, he wrapped himself in a towel, and took up a basin of water. He began to go from one disciple in the room to the next, washing their feet, taking the posture of a humble, common, everyday servant. After he had done this, he returned to the table. He looked at his disciples and said, "Right now you don't really understand what I'm doing or why I'm doing this, but soon enough it will make sense to you." As original Free Will Baptists, we practice the washing of the saints' feet. Because as one of my professors reminded me years ago, and anytime I see him to this day, he says that as Christians, we are a people of the basin and the towel. We may not practice the washing of feet when people come over for a visit to our homes today, but you and I still have a calling to be the hands and feet of Jesus in this world, to serve each other in both word and deed. These new brothers and sisters in Christ are being reminded that through this new relationship with God through Jesus Christ, they can now be the servants that God wants them and needs them to be in our world today. And if there's ever been a time in which we need more servanthood, I believe those days would be today. As our baptismal candidates and ministers and deacons go to the back to prepare for the service, I invite you all into a time of meditation and Christian reflection.
Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross and empty grave, life eternal, you have won the today shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh no, forever I am changed. So when I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. Yeah, he's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Glorious way.
This morning, brothers and sisters, Kelsey Smart comes on her profession of faith. As she's preparing to be baptized, I will ask her a couple of questions. First of all, Kelsey, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that he died on the cross for your sins, and that he was raised again on the third day to give you everlasting life?
Yes.
And do you promise to commit your life to Him, to serving Him all of your days, showing His love to the world in need? Having expressed her profession of faith, in obedience to the command of the Lord, we baptize her into new life. And in the words of the Apostle Paul to the believers in Rome, in chapter 6 of Romans, she is now buried with Christ and raised to new life.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
You are the light of the world. May God bless you as you grow in Christ. Palacio comes on his profession of faith, and as with Kelsey, I will ask him the following questions. Brody, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and He died on the cross for your sins?
Yes.
Do you believe that He was resurrected on the third day to give you new life?
Yes.
Do you promise from this moment forward to follow Him obediently and to make His love known in the world around us?
Yes.
Then in obedience to the command of our Lord and as a symbol of being dead in Christ and raised to new life, we now baptize you into the kingdom of God.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Brody, you are the light of the world. May God bless you as you grow in Christ. Brothers and sisters, Damian Jaimez comes today on his profession of faith. Damian, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and He died on the cross for your sins?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe that He was raised again on the third day to give you new life?
Yes.
Do you promise from this moment forward to follow Him obediently and make His love known to the world around us?
Yes.
And in obedience to the command of our Lord and as a symbol of new life in Christ, we baptize you into the kingdom of God.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Damian, you are the light of the world. May God bless you as you grow in Christ. Brothers and sisters, Naomi Palacio comes on her profession of faith. Naomi, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and He died on the cross for your sins? Do you believe that He was resurrected on the third day to bring you new life?
Yes, I do.
Do you promise from this moment on to be faithful and obedient to Christ and to share His love wherever you go?
Yes, I do.
Then in obedience to the command of our Lord, we baptize you as a symbol of being buried with Christ and raised up to new life.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Spirit. me you are the light of the world. May God richly bless you as you grow in Jesus Christ. Sisters, Coy Pritchett comes today on his profession of faith. Coy, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that he died on the cross for your sins?
Yes, sir, I do.
Do you believe that he was resurrected on the third day to bring you new life?
Yes, sir, I do.
Do you promise from this moment forward faithfulness to him as Lord and Savior and to let his love be known in the world around us?
Yes, sir, I do.
In obedience to the command of our Lord, as a symbol of being buried with Christ and raised to new life, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Coy, my friend, you are the light of the world. May God bless you and keep you and make his grace to shine upon you and give you strength.
Amen. Woo! Amen. As the musicians come, brothers and sisters, the altar is open. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, today can be the moment of your salvation. It's the greatest decision that you'll ever make in this life. More important than who you'll marry, more important than your career decisions. Maybe today you would like to come and recommit your life to following Christ more obediently. Perhaps it's been years and years since you've experienced the waters of baptism, and you feel as though that relationship with Christ has grown a little bit stagnant. Maybe there are needs that are pressing upon your hearts and minds this morning, or even praiseworthy items you would like to come and celebrate with your Heavenly Father. No matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart, this altar is open. Will we respond as God's Spirit is speaking?
Our Song of Commitment is page 309. Pass it on. Please stand.
Sooner or later, this side of heaven, it don't get any better than this. We have been so blessed today. We are a blessed church. We have a rich heritage. That we must, the calling has not stopped. The ministry of us individually sometimes does. But God is willing to bless us as we do His service here on earth. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord, may His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May His countenance shine upon you and give you peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with God the Father and Holy Spirit, one Lord, now and forever. Let us pray. Father, we praise your name because your name above all names is worthy to be praised. Lord, we love you because you loved us first and because you loved us the most by allowing your Son to go to Calvary for our sins. Lord, we pray for the offerings that are being given, multiply them to the benefit of this church in Little Rock and beyond as you see fit. God, be with us as we go our separate ways until the next appointed hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.